Hello friends, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Professor Vibhuti Patel, Head of the Department of Economics of SNET Women's University in Mumbai. Today's topic for discussion is legal position of women in India. We know that Indian state is considered as proactive when it comes to ensuring rights of women, and that in the post-independence period, we have seen that the legal position of women has enhanced as women are given citizenship rights, and the Indian women are also granted voting rights right from 1947. In 1950, when the Constitution of India was formed, the main architect of Indian Constitution, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, and his colleagues at Constituent Assembly, they were committed to gender justice. And as a result, what we see that the constitutional guarantees for empowerment of women are in place in our country. Constitutional guarantees for empowerment of women are as follows. Fundamental rights ensure empowerment of women through Article 14, which ensures equal rights and opportunities for men and women in political, economic and social sphere. Article 15 guarantees prohibition of discrimination against any group irrespective of their sex, religion, caste, ethnicity. Article 15(3), in which state is made to take affirmative action for empowerment. Article 16 provides for equality of opportunity in the matter of public appointments, and directive principles ensure empowerment of women through Article 39, which enjoins the state to provide for adequate means of livelihood to men and women. We also have equal pay for equal work. Article 42 of the state, there which talks about the ensuring of humane condition of work, and also maternity benefits. Fundamental duties of the state according to Article 51 V is first of all to ensure every citizen to announce any practice derogatory to women. When the government of India signed UN Charter on Equality, Development and Peace in 1975, International Women's Year, the process of gender audit in the governance got an official stamp. In 1976, for the first time, we got Equal Remuneration Act enacted to provide equal opportunities, equal treatment and equal wages to women for the work of similar nature. We have also seen that we have a specific laws regarding labor laws or a Factories Act 1948, section 34, which provides for the state government can lay down rules prescribing the maximum weight which can be carried by women and men. The Contract Labor Abolition Regulation Act, it rules that there should be separate provision of utilities for women, and there should be fixed working hours, so there should be labor standards be applied. In terms of protective legislations, our constitution ensures that what are the labor laws for empowerment of women that we need to know. Labor laws for empowerment of women are based on principle of gender justice. They are as follows. One is Equal Remuneration Act 76. Which many women have used in the post-independence period and in the after 1976. Maternity Benefits Act 1961 provides for 90 days of paid leave to working women. Factories Act 1948 section 34 provided for government can lay down rules for the maximum weight, and also Contract Labor Act which believes in certain labor standards, labor relations, labor processes to be applied for the contract labor who may have a temporary nature of work, but there has to be humane condition of work be provided to them. And we also have like so many new legal amendments that have come up. For example, women in the unorganized sector, there are laws, social securities and social protection of women in the unorganized, of workers in the unorganized sector. In the formal and organized sector, there are industrial legislations, and other protective legislations for workers, most of these legislative provisions, they are unfortunately, they seem to be working against the interest of workers, a lack of implementation, and they need reform. Government regulated minimum wages to ensure the bare essentials and for the survival of the people in the informal sector. We have factory inspectors, they usually avoid reporting as employers complain of low profitability. And we have also seen there are so many corrupt practices that also prevent it. In presence of crash in the industrial zone is also mandatory if there are more than 20 workers. There are no provision for providing crash in service sector and for both men and women working in shifts. So I think that is a greater need where workers and employees are demanding daycare centers. In India, the Equal Remuneration Act 1976 was enacted pursuant to Article 39D of the Constitution for providing payment of equal remuneration to men and women workers, for providing equal opportunities to women and men, and for prevention of discrimination on ground of sex against women in the matter of employment. The task of ensuring that is not discrimination is very, very difficult, as there are no effective ways of implementing the limited findings of the advisory committee. Secondly, the definition and evaluation of the same work or work of similar nature leaves much to be desired, and it is to the discretion of each implementing body. Even when the courts have used differential explanation, we have seen that the valuation of work has been very different in different situations. Maternity Benefits Act 1961, which provided for maternity benefits in case of childbirth, miscarriage, abortion, medical termination of pregnancy, and tubectomy. Establishments employing less than 10 persons are left out from this purview of the Maternity Benefits Act or the Employee State Insurance Act. Women's movement has demanded an umbrella legislation that covers all women from all formal organized sector as well as informal and unorganized sector under the maternity protection as per the ratification of ILO Convention number 183. We have had series of legal reforms in last 40 years. The Ministry of Labour and Employment, Government of India, they have also provided official gazette notification dated 31st March 2017, has appointed on 1st of April 2017, they have granted Maternity Benefits Amendment Act 2017, and it has come into force now. However, the relevant provision of a work from home option will come into effect from 1st July, that means just 3 days from now. The Act has increased paid maternity leave from existing 12 weeks to 26 weeks that could be availed by women for the period extending up to 8 weeks before the expected delivery date, and remaining 18 weeks can be availed post childbirth. For women who are expecting after having 2 children, the duration of paid maternity leave shall be 12 weeks, that means 6 weeks before and 6 weeks post expected date of delivery. The Maternity Benefits Act also provides maternity leave for adoptive and commissioning mothers in case of surrogacy. Maternity Benefits Act extends certain benefits to adoptive mothers as well as and provides that every woman who adopts a child shall be entitled to 12 weeks of maternity leave from the date of adoption. The Act has also introduced an enabling provision relating to work from home for women, which may be exercised after expiry of 26 weeks leave period. Depending upon the nature of work, women employees may be able to avail these benefits on terms that are mutually agreed with the employer. The Maternity Benefits Amendment Act makes crash facility mandatory for every establishment employing 50 or more employees. Women employees could be permitted to visit the creche 4 times during the day. Employees' awareness about the Maternity Benefit Amendment Act makes it mandatory for the employers to educate women about the maternity benefits available to them at the time of their appointment, and also whenever they need these services at the time of pregnancy. The concept of family leave has also been introduced, and minimum paid maternity leave to be applicable for working mothers irrespective of necessary length of their continuous service or number of employees, and irrespective of whether they are married or unmarried, or whether the child is natural born or adopted. The birth and adoptive fathers of the new child is entitled to paid paternity leave on the birth of or adoption of a child. Employee is also, they have to have time to take care of children, the disabled child or even a dependent child, for that also they are able to take paternity leave. Part-time working, temporary arrangement of say working pattern or a flexi time or request right available to working parents with young children below 5 years of age, or employees who have care for disabled or sick dependents. So these are the new amendments which we have seen. The request can cover employees, they will have right to return to work following availability of any of the above leave. The staff member must undertake in writing to return to the work. No employee shall suffer any kind of a detriment or any kind of a partiality or dismissal or discrimination against for using this kind of leave, or for pregnancy or childbirth or maternity or paternity or adoption, or any dependent who are disabled or elderly. There shall be no loss of seniority, sick leave entitlements or incremental progression. So this is a very, very welcome provision. When it comes to sexual harassment, to address the issue in both informal and small scale industries, free trade zones, special economic zones, labor departments have may be directed to set up a complaints committee. So it is not only the women who are in the organized sector and articulate who will get, who can avail this provisions from the act, but it is mandatory for each and every employer, industrial estate, neighborhood committee, societies, management committee of the societies, all of them have to adhere to this law. There are official bodies, trade unions, employers organizations and women's groups are playing very important role and active role in disseminating information about sexual harassment, redressal procedures in industrial zones and estates. They can also raise the issue of definition of skills, equal pay for comparable work, so as to tackle the gender inequality at the workplace. The sexual harassment at workplace has been one of the central concerns of the women's organizations, and now even the state, since after 30 years of consistent efforts, Indian women have managed to get this new act. First it was Vishakha directive, and now we have a Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace Prevention, Provision and Redressal Act 2013. Another very important law we have is about the legal protection for informal sector. That means the workers working in the unorganized sector who don't have regular job, the notice period, the compensatory pay or some form of unemployment insurance they need to get. It has been a long standing demand of representatives of informal sectors workers, trade unions, NGOs, that means non-governmental organizations, that workers should be registered as daily or piece rate workers with an identity card. So identity card is very important. This single act would provide information on the number of irregular workers and access to them for welfare measures. Social welfare for informal sector workers can be implemented by levying a cess on employers in the industrial estate. Social services can be dispensed to workers through variety of ways, that means existing government infrastructure that we have, or tripartite boards where employers organization, workers organizations and the state government representatives are there. There are also laws like to fight back violence against women. That means in the we have seen that after 2013, after the Delhi gang rape in a moving bus, the debates over social construction of gender that perpetuates sexual harassment, sexual violence in all walks of life have taken center stage in India. General public, community leaders, parents, youth, education providers, corporate, policymakers, politicians, the media, all are discussing prevalence of sexual violence in our society. Not only that, dialogue with the young man is also becoming very important. The masses spanning four generations have started discussion on the workplace safety in the context of misogyny, barbarism, influence of pornography, valorization of sadomasochist relations between men and women, and the influence of westernization on women's dress code or consumerist culture or hedonism, and how the chivalry towards women, which existed earlier, is now in a civilized or in a civilized culture, is now being replaced by hostility towards women. So we need to do massive public education, and also through our educational institutions and through family socialization. Because of the efforts of the child rights organization, we have seen that we have new law called POCSO, Protection of Children from Sexual Offence Act. We also, where the evil of child sexual abuse has been discussed openly in a public platform by the schools, by the parent teachers organizations. We also have that so many rules and regulations have been formed, code of conduct have been formed for the schools, like so many the schools have to have woman conductor where the children are taken from their residence to school. There are several IPC sections concerning violence against women. 304B talks about dowry death and dowry murder. Section 354 of IPC deals with criminal assault of women to outrage women's modesty, that means eve teasing and sexual street harassment. Section 366 deals with kidnap, abduction and marriage of a woman by force. Section 366A punishes procurement of minor girl. Section 366B of IPC deals with and punishes the offender of import of girl from the neighboring countries. Section 376 on rape has several clauses where the section 376A punishes the offense of intercourse by a man with his wife during judicial separation. Section 376B deals with intercourse by public servant with a woman in her custody, that means the custodial rape, what we call. Section 376C punishes intercourse by superintendent of jail remand home with a woman in his custody, and section 376D deals with the intercourse by any member of management or staff of a hospital with any woman in their hospital, whether she is a patient or a nurse or a doctor. Section 498A is very important, this thing where a husband or in-law subjecting a woman to cruelty becomes an offense against the state, demanding it is a it is a cognizable offense. Section 509 again deals with the harassment of women, which talks about outraging women's modesty. When it comes to property rights, I think there have been a long battle that is Indian women have waged. There is a much of a gender bias in the property laws in our country. We have religion-based family laws. We also have a 30,000 customary laws. Most of them deny property rights for women. Testimonial, the powers of daughters and property rights, housing rights of daughters, they were denied earlier. Thanks to the fight by Lata Mittal and her sister, we have now changed, like women were girl earlier. Now women have got right to housing and right to residence. And they have put private property, household property in the joint names of partners. A care, however, has to be taken that whatever women have property in their name, men did not appropriate this under the pretext of property being in joint name. So that care has to be taken. women on being abused in the matrimonial home, there is a little choice but for them to continue to endure it. Her natal household is usually unwilling to take her back for fear of social stigma attached to the single women, and even the married brothers would not like our sister coming back. These and other considerations restrict women's reliance on parents' household in times of potentially dangerous marital relations. On September 9, 2005, the Supreme Court of India granted women's right to ancestral property as per Hindu Succession Amendment Act 2005. And I think even the DVE Act, Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act, also takes care of this problem. The 73rd and 74th Constitutional Amendment, providing for 33% reservation of seats for women in panchayat and municipal corporations and municipal councils, has brought like more than 1 million women into the public domain. Women are represented in gram panchayat, tehsil panchayat, zilla panchayat, municipal councils and municipal corporations since 1994. UNDP report 2002 says, and I quote, "The evidence on gender and decentralization in India suggests that while women have played positive role in addressing the or attempting to address range of practical gender needs, that means without challenging the patriarchy, whatever the are the basic needs of the community in terms of tap water or electricity or public toilets or which reduces human drudgery and provides basic comfort, they have been able to address. Their response to immediate perceived necessity, which is like a in a specific context, they are practical in nature and often are concerned with inadequacies in living condition or as provision for fuel, water, healthcare, employment, and has been very commendable. But women have not been, elected representatives have not been able to meet the strategic gender needs because of the strong patriarchal forces which are hampering them to be fulfilled. So I think it is very important to empower and enhance the capacity of elected women representatives, and we have seen that in last 20 years of record of women's elected representatives was so good that more than 16 states in India have granted 50% reservation for women in Panchayati Raj institutions. Another very important law that we have got is a PCPNDT Act, Prenatal Diagnostic Techniques Prohibition of Sex Selection Act 2003, which has tightened the screws on sex selection at preconception stage and also put in place the strict very string of checks and balances to ensure that the act is effective in the prenatal diagnostic techniques regulation and prevention of misuse, Amendment Act 2002. And it has received president's assent in 2003. The act provides for prohibition of sex selection before or after conception and for regulation of prenatal diagnostic techniques for purpose of detecting genetic abnormalities or metabolic disorders or sex-linked disorders and for prevention of their misuse for sex determination leading to female feticide. And for that matter, and connected like therewith or incidental thereto, quote complete. There has been gross violation of PCPNDT Act, organizations are working. Another very important law that we have got in recent times has been Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act. After 30 years of consistent campaigning, we managed to get this act. It's extremely comprehensive. The act provides for more effective protection of rights of women guaranteed under constitution who are survivors of violence of any kind occurring within the family or for matters connected therewith or incidental thereto. The bill on domestic violence was circulated in 2002, which generated heated debates about the definition of violence and when casual or occasional beating was not considered as domestic violence, there was an uproar by the women's organization, and after massive signature campaign and lobbying, the Indian women managed to have this new law, which has very comprehensive definition of domestic violence, which encompasses psychological violence, physical violence, sexual violence, emotional violence, and also economic violence. That means sleeping, slapping, hitting, kicking, pushing, forced sex, showing pornography, obscene pictures or material, all this within the matrimonial, this thing, or a child sexual abuse, verbal abuse, name calling, insult, psychological, in economic violence, preventing one's wife from taking up a job or forcing her to leave the job, or if she's a housewife, not giving her enough money to run the house. Emotional abuse of any kind occurring within the family is considered as domestic violence. And it has also, this law has also given a major role to public hospitals, to criminal justice system, to lawyers, to shelter homes, and also emergency shelter is also covered under this law. The problem is that we need to allocate budgetary amount, because to make any law implementable, you need massive resources. This law also empowers women to stay in matrimonial home as well as share household or in the parental home. That means no husband can throw out his wife, or no father can throw out, or the brother can throw out his sister, or father can throw out his daughter. So that is a very, very, very important provision. There is a provision for protection officer, then the police has to play a very responsible role. Public hospitals have to register these cases under casualty, by casualty ward, and provide emergency medical services. So the scope of this legislation has been widened to include persons who have shared household and they are also related by consanguinity. That means if your children are cruel to parents, the law takes care of it. Marriage or relationship in the nature of marriage, that means all those who are living partners, they can also this thing. The adopted children, they are also covered under it. So sisters, widows, mothers, single women living with abusers, they are entitled to get protection under the DV Act. Now, there are so many important acts which are listed on the website of Ministry of Women and Child Development, and I think it is very important for any citizen or any responsible person in the country to know about this law. There are around 44 laws which touch the, closely touch the life of women. They are under the labor law, they can be criminal law, they are civil law, they are, and they all are respective ministries. They are, so the Ministry of Labor or Ministry of Industry, Ministry of Home Affairs, law and order issues are managed by Ministry of Home Affairs, Ministry or Law Ministry, and all these different government ministries as well as departments, they are interested to do this kind of continuous legal awareness. We have a legal aid cell, legal awareness cell. There has to be television in terms of public education, in terms of corporate social responsibility also, legal education is advocated and recommended by the government. In conclusion, I would like to reiterate the fact that Indian state has been proactive so far as the legal safeguards for women are concerned. We have seen the provision of protection of women under the 11th Five-Year Plan. We saw the Ministry of Women and Child Development, which was formed in 2006, has launched public education on laws concerning women. National Mission for Empowerment of Women also did a lot of review of all the laws related, around 44 laws which are linked to women's lives. And there is a realization that women's rights, we need to bridge the gap between what is there on paper and what is in reality. That means implementation has to be more effective, more targeted, and that's why I think society has to be alert about women and law. The women's groups, educational institution, society at large, community organizations, and also the criminal justice system has to be very, very, very powerful. Judicial activism can be strengthened by more proactive work done by our legal system.